Hello everyone, here's Dr. Mateus Rocha. Welcome to this first lecture. Today we're gonna talk about impression materials and dental stones, and we're gonna explore a little bit more of other technologies related to impression. So let's get started. So this is your routine nowadays. So basically you are every day treating your patient, trying to find the best treatment for them in the clinics. But sometimes you cannot make all the restorations direct to the mouth. Also, sometimes you need to have your patient with you so you can do walk-ups, you can do different types of planning. So that's why we need to have a good understanding of impression materials so we can replicate whatever's in the mouth of the patient to cast digital models. But how it's possible to duplicate those two structures so perfect? So we're gonna talk about contemporary impression materials today. So this is a very comprehensive lecture, so make sure that you're going to watch those topics, and then you're gonna write down, you can stop, pause. That's why we're having this recorded. But my goal today is to talk about basic principles for impression materials, talking about the three of the most important impression materials nowadays, alginate, PVS, and polyether. And then we're gonna talk about dental stones as well, and some new materials and technologies for dental impression. So, impression started a long time ago. We started with Dr. Philip Pfaff in Germany, and the first attempt to make an impression was trying to, a dental impression, I would say, was using beeswax. Of course, nowadays we don't use waxes anymore for final impression. We might use waxes for some, let's say, wax up casting, things in that direction. But Philip Pfaff already put some concepts that we still use to these days. So he was the first one to define the term impression in dentistry. So basically a definition of impression is an imprinted mold of an object such as tooth, arch of teeth, or dentulous ridge obtained by pressing the impression tray containing an impression material. Also, he defined what is a model. So a model is a positive reproduction, or I put here a cast, and I'll explain what is that, made from an impression of an object, okay? It's used for diagnostics, status record, or as even a base for the construction of prosthetic appliances, orthodontic appliances. But one thing that you need to pay attention, there is the difference between three nomenclatures: model, cast, and die. So model is basically the one that you use as a diagnostic, a study model, or something in that direction, where you're not gonna produce anything as a restorative work on that. You might consider a bleaching tray, but if you're considering a material, let's say a positive reproduction, to construct some prosthesis, this is the cast, all right? It's the working model, it's the cast. And die is a section of a cast. So for example, if you wanna make a crown, you remember my lectures on casting and also alloys, that you have to section the crown prep and trim that so you can make a crown design and then make the casting of that alloy. So that's a die, all right? And of course, Philip Pfaff also came with the ideal properties of an impression material. So the material, first of all, needs to be sufficient fluid to adapt to the oral tissues. Also needs to be viscous enough so you can place that on a tray. It cannot run like water. It needs to be a material that is able to transform, or I would say set, from a viscous liquid to a rubbery, to a rigid solid in the mouth in a reasonable time, so less than 7 minutes. You don't want a material that takes forever to do it. It needs to be resistant to distortion or tearing when removing from the mouth. And also the material needs to be dimensionally stable, because once you remove, you need time to pour the model, to pour the cast with that material. The material needs to be biocompatible. Of course, if you use a material that can cause irritation, cannot be used in healthcare, and needs to be cost effective. You don't wanna use a material that is very expensive, and there is a lot of equipment associated to that. So having those properties in mind, we can understand the properties that the materials in general, especially the contemporary impression materials, they will have. So here's the classification of all impression materials that you can have, all right? So here you can have materials that are, we consider reversible and irreversible. Also, we can have materials that we can consider inelastic and elastic materials, okay? So these are the main properties. And within the classification, you can see all the materials available that can be used. I wouldn't say available, but can be used as impression materials, all right? Most of those, you're gonna see that they're extinguished, that we don't use anymore because they're past, but it's important to understand some of those. So for example, let's understand first the concepts of reversible and irreversible. So a material that is called, let's say, reversible, it is a material that can go from the viscous liquid to the solid state reaction back and forth. So for example, material that was used in the past for a long period is wax. So think about the wax that are used for wax ups. So you can warm that wax and then adjust that, let's say, to the teeth and then make an impression with that. But of course, this is not reliable enough. Materials that are reversible, they tend to not be that stable. And also we have what we call irreversible. So those are materials that once the setting reaction happens, the material cannot return to its original state, let's say. So what happened is that material will stay as it is. So a good example, you have used that before, is the alginate, is the PVS. And the materials can be inelastic or rigid and elastic materials, all right? The difference is that the elastic material will allow forces to compress or to put tensile forces on that material. And once those forces, they are removed, the material will recover to its original shape. That's called elastic recovery of the material. And there are materials that are inelastic, so the material will be deformed. So for example, impression compound. Impression compound can be used for impression, of course, but it's more towards border molding when you're doing complete dentures nowadays. But it's a material that is inelastic. Once the material is set, you cannot have any type of, let's say, deformation on that material. The material will fracture. So just think that you don't use impression compound in dentated patients. It's only for board molding in a dentulous patient. All right. So let's just have an understanding of the materials here that are basically in the past. I recommend you to read the book chapter to understand more about them. But here we have, as inelastic materials, wax and plaster of Paris. Wax, as I said, you still have waxes that can be used for other purpose, but not for impression. Even for bite restriction, if some people use waxes, it's not the ideal. Plaster of Paris is basically extinguished. I will talk about stones later, but plaster of Paris is basically one of the first materials that was used for impression. Now, we have other materials that you still can find around for impression. Some people might use still in some conditions, and especially in different countries, they might have different type of materials. For example, impression compound. Here in the US, we still use impression compound for border molding, all right? In many other countries as well. Zinc oxide eugenol paste is also used for complete dentures. Those are inelastic materials, all right? The zinc oxide eugenol paste is basically a paste that we call Lysandra. You might see around in the clinics. And then you can spatulate and then you can use for complete dentures. We rarely use those. Agar is a material that is very rare to find nowadays. It's basically is a solution like a gelatin-based solution where depending on the temperature, you can have some trays that have some water type of cooling systems that you heat up the material and then you make the impression, then you pass some cool water on the tray and then the material will cool down and will make the impression. The material is very precise, but it requires a machine for it. It's you use basically the same agar for several patients, so the cross-contamination is it's insane, it's not nice, so it's extinguished. No one would use that. Polysulfide is a material that we still have in the clinics. This is a material that can be used. It's a type of condensation silicon, and also I will enter in condensation silicon here. So those are materials that are silicon-based or people call rubber-based, which is not the right name to talk about, but okay. These materials, they are materials that they react and have the siloxane groups and have the reaction of condensation, all right? So because these materials, they have this reaction through condensation, they have a lot of byproducts. So a condensation silicone and a polysulfide will release different different type of components, especially ethanol is the main one, and these can evaporate and then the material can have problems. Besides that, these materials shrink a lot because they are having the condensation condensation reaction. All these spaces that you have in between the monomers, they tend to go together and then they shrink a lot. So these sometimes are used, for example, polysulfide. If you have a custom tray that is well adapted and you cannot make an impression with PVS or polyether, which most of the times you can try to use this. But this is an outdated material. It's a material that the smell is too strong. Use type of a catalyst that is based on lead and sulfur. So it's not a material nice to be used, although some people still use. Condensation silicones, they are a little bit better than the polysulfide for these conditions, but still the shrinkage of these materials is too high, right? So you're gonna see that we have better options and materials, but I wanted you to have in mind that these materials exist and you might see around. Don't get confused, all right? In the clinics, you might see those, that dark paste that is polysulfide, all right? So you need a custom tray. There are a couple of things that I need to go through, all right? And then we have the materials that are most likely the materials that you're going to be using on a daily basis. You have the materials that are called irreversible elastic. So a lot of people will call those elastomeric impression materials, although they can classify with different names. So these will be the alginate that is probably the most cost-effective material for diagnostic impressions. And we have materials for final impressions that are gonna be the polyvinyl siloxane, the PVS, some people call addition silicone as well, and polyether. So we're gonna explore these more in depth. So just for you to know, go ahead to the book chapter that is on Canvas and read about the other materials because there are important things for you to know about those. So let's talk about these three, alginate, PVS, and polyether, all right? Let's start with the alginate material. For the alginate material, it's a material that, first of all, is indicated for study and diagnostic models, all right? You should not use this for final impressions, all right? People sometimes do pick up impressions with those just as a transitional phase, maybe for interim partial, okay, but pay attention because the material is not precise enough. It can be used to make to make working casts for custom trays, then later we'll use polyether or PVS. You can use for bleaching trays because it doesn't require that much of precision on bleaching trays. You can do orthodontic appliances as well because those can be slightly adjusted and of course the fitting is not the major thing. And also as an antagonist cast, all right? So if you have a cast that you want to put as opposing to some models, you can use this material as well. The alginate composition will be the powder and the liquid, all right? The powder is gonna be an alginate powder and I will show the composition. The water is basically distilled water. And the thing is a water-based material, so there are a lot of advantages and disadvantages regarding that. So here in the alginate powder composition, it's very important to understand what is the role of each one of those. So we have the potassium alginate, that is the soluble alginate, is the one that will create the matrix that will hold everything together and create this part of elasticity to the material. We have the calcium sulfate and sodium phosphate. Those are the ones that will trigger the reaction to the formation of the alginate, let's say the final alginate material that I'll show shortly. We have the fillers that can be diatomaceous earth, zinc oxide, sometimes silica as well. So those are to give consistency to the material. So you have a material that has the right flow to the cavity. And we have potassium titanium fluoride. So potassium titanium fluoride is the one that will ensure compatibility with the gypsum, okay? You're gonna see that on the gypsum, we have calcium sulfate as the main ingredient. So sometimes what can happen is, depending on the length of the contact of the alginate with the stone, you can cause problems on the stone. So let's focus on these three first here to understand the reaction of the alginate. So the alginate reaction, it's basically happens in two stages, all right? Although these happen at the same time, this is how you can break down to understand. So you start having the reactor and retardant in a water solution. So basically, you have the powder, you mix with water. So the first thing that happens is the reactor will react with the retarder. So the retarder will produce calcium phosphate and sodium sulfate until the retarder is completely consumed. So this is important because if you only have the reactor, you won't have working time to mix the material and to make the impression. So the retarder is added to the composition exactly to control the working time of the material. And once the retarder is completely consumed, the reactor then will start to react with the potassium alginate, that is the soluble alginate, and then will form what we call calcium alginate, that is the main matrix for it. And also there is a byproduct, or let's say a second product that is generated on that reaction, that is potassium sulfate. In the reaction, the calcium alginate is the main matrix, but you have to pay attention that everything surrounding that matrix is going to be a solution, a water solution of these salts here. They are in the composition, okay? And then we have the water temperature, all right? So basically the alginate depends on the water temperature. So the manufacturing instructions, they will talk about the water, the setting time based on room temperature. So if you see a regular alginate, I think the ones that are using the clinics is gel trade. The mixing time is about 60 seconds. The working time is 2 minutes and 15 seconds. And the setting time is 3 minutes and 30 seconds. But if you use different temperatures, let's say that you want to make the setting time shorter, you can use hot water. But pay attention, everything, it will change. Mixing time, working time, and setting time, okay? Everything will become faster. And remember the concepts and the definitions of these. These are on the book, but I will explain here pretty quick. Mixing time is the time that you have to put all the powder and liquid together and mix and have a homogeneous mixture. Working time is the time that you have to deliver that material to the tray and execute the impression and have the impression stable. Setting time is the amount, is the time that you need for the material set in a situation almost complete in a way that the material will have a elastic recovery whenever removed from the mouth. And if you use cold water, everything will start to be longer. So pay attention with all of that. My recommendation is always use room temperature water because that time is enough and you don't want to change that much. If you decide to make it a little bit faster, you can use, of course, the hot water, or I would recommend using a fast set alginate. So those are very good for situations like pediatric dentistry and also ortho, because the models, we can use alginate in the fast set. Very nice. One recommendation that normally the manufacturers, they will say is avoid using tap water because it might contain some minerals, magnesium, calcium, sodium that can delay the time and in extreme cases might prevent the gelification. Of course, this is not gonna be something visible, but it might happen that when you remove the alginate, it will see that it's tearing in the, especially on the abrasive spaces. So one of the things that can happen is the use of not a completely free of contaminant water, all right? It's different from stone. Stone, you don't care too much about the type of water. But on the alginate, it's interesting to use distilled water or even a bottle of water that does not contain a lot of minerals. Commercial packaging. So it comes in pouches. That's the type of that it's very interesting to use. It comes everything sealed and all that pre-weighted. You can use the bag as well. So the bag comes in a bulk and then you have several doses to be used. You can use also from the plastic jar. All right. My recommendation is if you buy the pouches, which is the ideal, ends up being a little bit more expensive. So And sometimes the pouches are for three doses, and you don't need sometimes all the time three doses. Let's say that you're making preliminary impression for a dentalus ridge. You can use two or one dose, so you might waste material. If you have a bag, I recommend putting the content of the bag in a plastic jar. The plastic jar is basically the ideal situation because you can control the amount of powder that you're gonna use. You can close the lid and prevent the material to be exposed to humidity. Remember, it's a material that will set with water, so if you have humidity, that's a problem for the material to have premature setting. And you can have, as I said, regular set and fast set. Very likely you're gonna use a regular set in the school, but sometimes as time goes, you might end up using fast set if you're doing mainly preliminary impressions with the alginate. Now we're gonna talk about the six phases here that are important related to the use of the alginate. So the first one is proportioning, all right? So the proportioning of alginate will depend on two little devices. One is the scoop that you're gonna be using, and the other one is the vial with the amount of water that you're gonna have here. So the marks, how many milliliters of water is for each one of those. So for each scoop, it's in general 8 grams of alginate, and for each part of water is gonna be 19 milliliters of water. So you can see how water is important on this reaction. So to make sure that you have correctly picking up the powder, first of all, you have to turn over the plastic jar several times so you can make the powder a little bit more fluffy. Sometimes you can sieve that powder, but nowadays the manufacturers already are gonna bring that powder a little bit sifted for you. If you take a look on this video and pay attention, whenever I turn the jar several times and open, there is a powder that comes off. You see the dust? Don't breathe that, don't smell that, because that's silica. If you inhale that for a long period, you might have a silicosis that is a very severe lung disease. And then to load the scoop, there is a technique for it. So you have to progressively load and tap that to the walls of the jar and make sure to not compress the powder. And once you're done, you tap the scoop and then cut flush all the excess. If you end up compressing the powder, you might end up with more alginate that you need, and that will be a problem. Also, if you don't load the scoop progressively, what's gonna happen is that you're gonna have a lot of voids inside. Now, if you want to use the ideal situation, you should weight the scoop, so it should have 8 grams. But of course, sometimes clinically, it's not the reality. So my recommendation is, if your alginate mixture is not coming nice, you should practice a little bit, and then you can use the scale to weight to see if you're putting too much powder or not putting enough powder. And remember, in a few years, you're gonna be teaching your dental personnel to make the impressions for you. So that's a good way to teach them how to collect the right amount of alginate based on the weight. So that's an important thing regarding proportioning. Now comes the mixing, okay? The mixing of the alginate, you have basically different types of mixing. You have manual mixing, you have the alginator, that is a bowl that you can spin and mix the alginate, and you have also the alginate mixer, that is an asymmetric centrifugal mixing machine, okay? So we're gonna start here with the manual mixing. That is probably the most common one. So what you're gonna use is a rubber bowl. The rubber bowl is important because you want to deform the bowl to adapt the spatula to the bowl. You're going to need also a spatula. It can be either a plastic or a metal spatula. My only recommendation is don't use the same spatula that you use for the stone, okay? Because the stone contains calcium sulfate that will start the reaction of the alginate a little bit faster. So pay attention with that. And here is the mixing. First is the water and then the powder. So pre-weigh the powder in a cup. And then you start the first 10 seconds to 15 is just to add the powder. If you try to go fast right in the beginning, what's gonna happen is you're gonna have powder all over. Once you're done, you're gonna start to use your left or non-dominant hand to rotate the bowl, and with the spatula, you compress the alginate mixture against the walls of the bowl. And then you should obtain a mass of alginate that is smooth and should be shiny on the surface without voids, all right? Try to do everything within the mixing time of 60 seconds. After that, you're gonna load the tray with the impression material. But before you do that, and before you start mixing, it's very important to apply a little bit of alginate tray adhesive. So this is ensuring that the alginate will stay on the tray. It's not something that is gonna make a miracle. That's why we need to use perforate trays for alginate impressions. So alginate impressions, the ideal type of tray should be complete trays. It can be plastic or metal, and ideally should be trays that either they have a perforation, but small perforations, or should be the one with border retention, okay? My favorite one would be the metal with border retention, but you're gonna see that these are pretty hard to use because you have to have many of those. There's cross-contamination that can happen. That's why you need to sterilize all of them. In terms of logistic on sterilization, it's pretty hard. So that's why the most popular one and the one that I've been using the most is the plastic trays, all right? It's the one that we use in the clinics. But again, avoid using partial trays with alginate. It doesn't work that well. So now it's the impression part. You're gonna start on the posterior side, and then you're gonna make sure that the material will start to flow to the anterior portion. And then you are all set with that. Now you're gonna maintain everything stable, all right? Don't ask the patient to hold because the patient will press too much and then will deform. So you have to stay there for the during the setting time, okay? So you're gonna have the working time, you're gonna wait for the setting time, so always have a timer with you. This is better because sometimes the patient might have some gag reflex or some anxiety. So if you have the timer with you, you can have control of the situation. There are techniques for making the impression, so position of the patient, you all learn that in PROS. Now is the part of the impression removal. Impression removal is as important as all other steps that I'm mentioning here. So for the impression removal, what you need to understand is that there is a property that is called viscoelastic property. So that's what we call elastomeric impression materials. If you go to the book, you're gonna see this part. When you're reading that, it's called Maxwell Kelvin Vault model that explains based on springs and pistons how these materials, they will work. But basically there is a very interesting way to understand those. So think about these materials here, the silly putty. So the silly putty is a material that it's used for kids to play, and is a material that presents a viscoelastic behavior. What is that? So it's a material that if you apply a low rate of force, is a material that will have a plastic deformation. But if you apply a high rate of force, is a material that will have what we call elastic rebound or elastic recovery. So the same thing applies to impression materials. So if you try to remove the material slowly, rocking the impression, you're gonna deform completely the impression, so you ruin that. But if you remove in one quick and a single movement, the model to do is way better. So how should you do that? You should break the seal on one side and pull the impression from the patient's mouth. Disinfection is very important because you're gonna have to pour that. So there are very, very, very different methods for disinfection, immersion and all that. The ideal method to disinfect alginate is to use a spray. So there are two types of sprays that you can use, a monochloride or sodium hypochlorite. Sodium hypochlorite, you're gonna see that it requires 10 minutes of contact, and also you have to buy new ones every week. Ammonium chloride, that is opticide and cavicide, that is the ones that we're having in the clinics. Those are the ones that you can have a minimum contact time depending on concentration, 3 or 5 minutes. Our protocol is 5 minutes, and you can use that with a shelf life of 1 year. So ammonium chloride is a good one. So make sure to spray the alginate material and then at least 5 minutes. But you cannot leave the alginate impression hanging around. Again, it's a material that basically, I would say 70 to 80% of the composition is water. So in this case, Place the alginate impression inside a plastic bag with a paper towel soaked in water under the tray. Sometimes you might want to wrap around. You don't need to do that, okay? Sometimes you put too much water on the paper and the water starts to drip into the prep. So if you're having a plastic bag, that's more than enough, okay? With a paper towel soaked in water, that's it. You don't need to waste too much time of wrapping around. So avoid doing this, because what happens is once the alginate is formed, you have water, as I said, in the composition, the calcium alginate that is holding everyone together, and the salt also there is going to be diluted in the water. So if you leave that in a normal and ambient humidity, the material will shrink because the water will evaporate. And this shrinkage is called syneresis, all right? It's not evaporation, it's syneresis. It's a typical physical chemical reaction. So here you have a calcium alginate, water, and salt that is in a different situation. Let's say that you leave immersed in water. Let's say that you want to leave in a solution. What's going to happen is because of the salt present on that, you will, through osmosis, bring the water from the solution into the alginate, causing expansion. And this process is called imbibition, all right? So pay attention also. That's another thing to consider. So again, if you have one of these processes during the step of removing the impression and pouring the cast, of course the cast is going to be terrible. If you have imbibition, the model will look larger. If you have syneresis, the model will look narrow. And again, this is the best way to do. You're going to apply the disinfectant. Then you wash that, and then you can put that on the tray. Now, you can wrap around, but as I said, you notice here, this is a very common mistake. You leave the paper here with so much water that the areas, especially in prawns, that you have the borders here, end up with a lot of water, and then it doesn't look nice. And sometimes when you're pouring the cast, it tears apart. So avoid wrapping completely around. If it's okay inside the plastic bag with a paper towel, that's more than enough. That can cause some imbibition on the areas. Make sure that after you apply the disinfectant or the material stays on the disinfectant for the period, rinse for 30 to 60 seconds to remove the excess of disinfectant, because that can also deteriorate a little bit the material. The ammonium chloride can react with some of the salt that is inside. So make sure to rinse that from 30 to 60 seconds. All right, so now that you have your impression disinfected inside the plastic bag, it's time for pouring. So that's one of the most common mistakes that I see happening, is that people wait too long to pour the alginate. Think about the alginate impression only stops when you have when you remove your stone, okay? Until if you think that putting on the bag will solve your issue, that you can basically dismiss the patient and everything solved, that's not a good critical thinking. Because what happened is, if you mess on the pouring of the stone, alginate cannot be re-poured, all right? There's a material that you can only pour one time. So it's very important that you organize your clinic setting where while you are making the impression, and later after the impression, you go ahead and do other things with the patient appointment. Have your associate, have someone pouring the impression right away for you, because if you need to retake the impression, imagine bringing the patient back only to retake an impression. It's very frustrating. So here, you should pour the cast immediately, all right? There are some books that say that you can wait 24 hours in a humid environment. Yes, but those cause so many problems. Just take a look on the cast that sometimes I see you're hanging around in the journal senior lab. They are completely distorted. Whenever you're going to go and mount them, they don't fit well. So go ahead and plan that accordingly. It doesn't take too much time for you to go ahead and pour the cast. So after you finish the impression, you can pour a cast in 5 minutes, and then you can come back and wait the stone to set and continue the appointment. So pay attention with that. And again, if you don't respect that, you're going to have the snares and imbibition on that model. All right. we're going to talk about more about pouring going forward, but I want you to have this knowledge about alginate. All right, so now we already passed the alginate part. So let's move ahead and talk about the other materials. So before we start that, let me show you something very interesting. You know what I'm showing here? It's a vinyl record. So that's a very unique way to listen to music. So basically on the vinyl record, you have all the sound waves engraved on the surface of the vinyl record. And whenever you have a needle that is very, very small, can pass on those grooves will basically move the needle, and that needle will go, is connected to an amplifier, and that will make the sound. So if you think about, you know, what is the size of these grooves? They measure about 25 to 50 microns. It's exactly the precision of a PVS material or other materials that we have available for final impression. Alginate is not gonna have that precision, but if you can copy those, maybe you can copy anything in dentistry. So I'm, as a crazy person, I decided to make a quick experiment. So I got the vinyl record, I made a custom tray for the vinyl record, and then I bought some industrial PVS. It's just more, it's cheaper than the dental. But in this case, I put the disc on the custom tray, and then I pour that disc. I made an impression of that disc with a PVS material. So after 24 hours, that the time that takes for that to set, you see how different is an industrial and a clinical PVS, and the clinical PVS is way better than this one. I can remove, and then I can see the grooves on the material. And then I could pour with stone, but that would be insane because it would be too heavy. So I pour with epoxy resin. So basically I wait again 24 hours for the epoxy resin to set. And what I did, I removed the impression, and then I was able to have a duplicate of the vinyl record. So now you can ask, can PVS be precise enough? Epoxy resin, of course, is very precise, but can I make the copy of this and how those discs will sound? So let's see.
Tonight,
here's the sound
I'm
gonna
have myself a real good time. I feel alive.
So now imagine what you can do in dentistry. So this material that I used for that was polyvinyl siloxane. Of course, I use an industrial one, but it's the same one that we use in dentistry. So the polyvinyl siloxane, or PVS, it can be used for study and diagnostic models. So for example, if you're doing an walk-up of a static case, it's way better to do with PVS that, because you're gonna do later a mock-up, a putty, let's say guides for reduction. So alginate sometimes it's not precise enough for those type of very precision work. So you can do study and diagnostic models with PVS, and I highly encourage you to do it. You can do any type of working cast. So you can, of course, make the cast and create any type of restorative work that you're thinking about. The composition of the PVS basically comes in two cartridge, all right? These cartridges come to connected in a dual barrel type of situation. So in both cartridges, you're gonna have fillers. And the fillers that you're gonna have is either that Damascus earth or silica, especially silica, colloidal silica. That's the most common one. And this filler will dictate if the material has the different viscosities. So in this case, the base part is gonna contain some of the monomers. It will contain the polymethyl hydrosiloxane is the monomer S, so have that in mind. And we have the monomer V, divinyl polysiloxane. And on the catalyst part, you're gonna have the monomer also V, okay? And we have as a catalyst a platinum salt, all right? Memorize that because that's very important for many clinical applications and understanding the material. So with a PVS composition, you can understand how it's gonna be the PVS polymerization reaction. So you have the catalyst here that can act on the monomers V, All right. And once these monomers V are in contact with the monomer S, the siloxane, they can connect together forming a polymer of the monomers V and S. So that way you're going to have these materials adding to each other in an addition polymerization reaction, which is a reaction that has minimal shrinkage and basically no byproducts. So that way you form the polymer of the monomers V and S. That will be PVS polyvinyl siloxane. The commercial packaging of these materials, it can come in a putty that will be two plastic jars that you can mix the base and catalyst. Also, you can have hand cartridges that will have the base and catalyst in a dual barrel, as I said. And you can have bulk cartridges where you can have basically the same type of material in the hand cartridges, but in a dynamic mixing system, which will allow you to have materials that are a little bit more heavy in the bulk cartridges. And here are the viscosities. So you're going to find different types of viscosities like extra low and or extra light body, low and light body, medium or regular body, heavy body, and putty. All right. Those are the most common ones. And this will depend on the application. You can have a light body material to make multiple mix technique, and then you can use that on the prep and on the tray. If you use a light body, it will spill all over, so you need to use either a heavy body or a putty. So the materials also come in different setting times. You have regular set and fast set. My recommendation is to have the regular set is the most common one. Sometimes you want to have a fast set. If you're doing very quick impressions, for example, if you're doing occlusal guards, sometimes it's nice to have a medium viscosity or heavy viscosity fast set material because that will be more comfortable for the patient. And PVS will follow the same principles that we're discussing: proportioning, mixing, impression, impression removal, disinfection, and pouring. So let's talk about these. So proportioning and mixing, all right? I'm going to put these together because they are basically happening at the same time. So for the plastic jar and or putty material, you have to do the hand mixing. For the hand mixing of PVS, it's very important to not use latex gloves, all right? Remember the catalyst that I mentioned, the platinum salt is the catalyst that if gets in contact with any type of sulfonate compound, it can react, and that will not start the reaction of the PVS. So the latex glove will contain potassium dithiocarbamate that will, in this case, inhibit the polymerization of PVS. So whenever you're hand mixing, try to use nitrile gloves or clean your hands, and then you can use those. So for the proportioning here, it's pretty straightforward. You're going to have a base where you have the spatula, and then you can have a small spatula just to remove the excess and cut flush. This way you have the right amount of material. And also you can have the material separated. Make sure to clean the spatula if you're going to use that. And then you can use the other spatula for it. And then you can cut to both sides. And then you have the right amount of material. Now it's time for mixing. There is a technique for mixing that. You put one on the top of the other. You start to twist, and then after you twist and make sure that everything is well spread, you start to press with your thumb against your fingers, and that way you're going to have a homogeneous mixture. The technique is not going to, let's say, make it mixed better or not. It's just make you mix faster, all right? So then you can have more time to work. So if you respect the technique that I just demonstrated, you're going to see that the material will mix way faster than if you just randomly try to do it. So the other method of mixing and proportioning is the hand cartridges, that where you're going to use the static mixing. So with the static mixing, you're going to have the material that basically comes on the hand cartridge. And with that type of gun, you're going to see that you have the it marks there that is 1-to-1, 2-to-1. Those are the most common ones. So you start loading the gun with the material, make sure that it's locked. You remove the cap. You should inspect to see if the materials are, the cartridges are aligned on this area. Once it's done and aligned, you can go ahead and make sure to put the mixing tip. The mixing tip, you're going to notice that some mixing tips, they have color coded. So Majority of the PVS will use a yellow mixing tip for light material. And once you press, what happens is that the material will travel both pastes. They will travel through this mixing tip and will create a vortex which will mix the material. Now, here it is how it works. So you can see that the materials are coming in, not mixing in the beginning, and as they travel through, they will go and end up completely mixed at the end here. So every time you're using the cartridge and it's the first part that is being squeezed from the hand cartridge, every time you're making an impression, you have to bleed these first part of the mix, all right? What happens with that is that sometimes, remember, the cartridge, although they try to be aligned as much as we can, there's always something a little bit, there's always entering a little bit more of base or catalyst, so you should remove and discard this first part. And we have dynamic mixing. The dynamic mixing are machines that can create a vortex automatically, so you don't have to press the cartridge. So the way it works is you put the machine, the cartridge into the machine. There is a button on the machine that you press and will create this vortex, and the material comes from that. You bleed the first part, and then you can load the tray using that material. So this is very interesting because you can load the tray pretty fast, so that way you don't have to waste too much time. Now, for the impression, it's basically the same technique as I mentioned for the alginate, all right? But I wanna make sure that you understand the details of this technique, because on alginate, you're using basically a one consistency material. Now you have a more precise technique where you can use different materials. So pay attention regarding the order of the materials of that you're using, and also some of the tips on the technique. So first of all, on the tray adhesive, you're not gonna use the universal or alginate tray adhesive. You're gonna be using the PVS tray adhesive. So you're gonna see these tray adhesive that comes for asilicons. So you're gonna pass this on the tray. It's very important to add those because sometimes the trays, even with the retention, the material will not have enough tear resistance to stay on the tray, and they might lift, which cause problems during the impression. But pay attention, because those are for PVS or asilicons. They are different from the alginate and the polyether that I'm gonna show in a few minutes. Now, it's very important. You should read that in the chapter as well. There are three techniques that you can use with these type of elastomeric materials. You can use what we call putty wash technique. You can use multiple mix technique or monophase technique. So let's start with putty wash. Putty wash is a technique where basically you do a preliminary impression with a heavier putty material with some spacer in between. You can use sort of a plastic bag or any type of polypropylene type of plastic that you use to make that spacing. And you make a preliminary impression. You wait that material to set first, and then you remove. So that material will have almost as a custom tray made with putty. And then what you can do is you can apply the light material, and then you can reinsert the tray with the putty material, and then you're gonna wash that. So the wash part, you use the light material for it. What are the advantages of that technique? If you're doing a very large arch, this gives you a little bit more of working time, okay? So that way you do first the impression with the putty, then you can go and have more time to work with the light material. In the past, people use that for condensation silicons with a simple rationale is that, oh, the condensation silicons, as I said in the beginning of the lecture, they will shrink. So if they shrink, if I compensate the shrinkage with the putty shrinking all first, when I use the light, I just have a very small amount of shrinkage, which is great. So if you're using a condensation silicon, mercaptan, or polysulfide, you need to use putty wash technique for it. Or you need to have a custom tray for condensation silicons, all right? But what are the advantages of putty wash technique with PVS and polyether? Polyether will explain, but PVS here that we're talking now, first of all, those are additional silicon materials. So they have basically, they have literally no shrinkage. So basically, there's no need for compensate for the shrinkage, all right? Second, almost the setting times is enough for majority of the dentists. So 2 minutes to make impressions, it's a great time. It's enough time for majority of the impression. But the thing is, if you use a buddy wash technique with a PVS elastomeric material, when you reinsert the PVS buddy with the tray back to wash the material, sometimes what happens is you might end up putting too much pressure, and the material sometimes also can generate some compression in some areas. And if you don't have enough channels for the material to flow out, the material will deform the putty. So the material, the elastic material, the light material will set while the putty base is deformed. Remember, the putty is elastic. So once you remove that, the putty will come back to its original shape and then will deform the entire type of impression. So what I suggest is avoid using putty wash techniques unless it's completely required, and make sure that you create the channels to flow the material through it. Multiple mix technique is the one that is the most common use and the ones that you're gonna be executing in clinics. Ideally, you should have two people working on it. So while the primary provider is putting the light material on the prep, what the assistant is doing is getting that material and putting on the tray. That way, both materials, putty on the tray or heavy on the tray and light in the mouth, they will be pressed against the tissues and they will set together at the same time. This way, you don't have issues with the areas of being overcompressed. Second, if the part was not copied by the light material, is because the heavy material was enough to copy that, because the heavy material will squeeze the light material into those areas. So that's the one that you're gonna be using the most and the ones that we're gonna be practicing, all right? Monophase is the one that you're gonna use a medium viscosity. So those are the ones for the cases where you're doing complete dentures, impressions for RPDs. So most of the cases you're gonna be using a monophase, and that's for a medium viscosity. All right, it's only one type of material being used at once. All right, now for the impression of PVS, there are two very important aspects here, and those are the most common mistakes that I see happening in clinics. One is understanding water incompatibility of PVS, and the second one is understanding the things related to sulfonate compounds. All right, now this is the time that you need to pay attention, all right? This is the part that you're gonna write down everything that I'm saying right now, record this part in a short video later, because this is gonna change your life with final impressions using PVS. Now, let's talk about water incompatibility. Although the manufacturers, they say that their materials, they are hydrophilic, those materials, they are not hydrophilic at all. They are hydrophobic, okay? Why they're saying they are hydrophilic? Because they put inside the composition surfactants. So the surfactants is to ensure that the material will have better affinity to water. But that's not for you to make better impressions in the mouth, because the surfactants, they need more time to act and break the surface tension of the water to work and make the material wet. This hydrophilic, it's only to ensure compatibility with the stone. So pay attention with that, because the hydrophilic doesn't mean much, all right? So this is just for the stone. Again, PVS is a hydrophobic material and it will repel or fail to mix with water. So rule number one that you need to write down, the prep and the gingival tissues that you're trying to make the impression need to be dry, completely dry. There is no way that if you have a moisture environment that you're gonna get a nice impression, okay? So here is an example, a dry surface of a coin. So let's try to copy that with a PVS. Perfect, you can do a beautiful job. Now, if I put some droplets of water on the crown and try to make the impressions, you can see that the PVS cannot squeeze the water out. And that's a nightmare, because in that way, you're gonna have some voids in bubbles in your prep. All right, so you must write the area of impression where you're going to make the impression. So now let me make myself bigger on the screen and explain you the steps whenever you're making the impression with the PVS. Let's say that you make an impression of a crown, okay? And then what do you need to do? You need to use what we call double core technique, all right? So how does the double core technique works? You place the 000 or sometimes 00, most of the time 000 is the rule of thumb, cord into the sulcus, all right? This way, the 000 will control the crevicular fluid. So pay attention. The first cord is to be used to control crevicular fluid. So there is no water coming, no moisture coming to your prep margins. So now ask yourself, should I put the retraction cord dry or should I soak that in any liquid? Just think about it. If the goal of the cord is to retain the moisture, you should use a dry cord, all right? So you put a dry retraction cord into the sulcus to control and suck all the moisture. But you might be asking, Dr. Rocha, sometimes what happens is it's bleeding on that area. And then I have to put some hemodent on that. So what I do, I soak my cord on hemodent. All right. You can do that, but whenever you're doing the impression, it cannot be soaked on hemodent. So how does hemodent should be used? First of all, the first thing that you need to do is try to get a gauze and compress the tissue and stop the bleeding, all right? Or get a dry retraction cord a little bit bigger and compress the tissue. This, I would say 90% of the cases will solve the issue. Unless, let's say the patient has a gingivitis or has a high BOP on that area, sometimes you can't do that. But let's say that you need to control that. You put a retraction cord with a hemodent, but once you are on the stage of making the impression, you need to remove that and put the dry retraction cord, okay? So pay attention, dry retraction cord all the time that you're making the impression. And just for your information, if you read the retraction cords that we have in the clinics, the UltraDent, UltraPack, they contain hemostatic agents, all right? Those ones, if there is water or blood coming into the retraction cord, they will have some hemostatic agent that will come to that area and will create a coagulation on that cord. So there's no need to put more liquid on it, more hemostatic agent, all right? Pay attention with that. All right, so just returning, I just put the dry retraction cord over there. 000. So now I'm gonna put another cord. The cord that I'm gonna put now is a zero cord or sometimes a cord number one. So this cord is not to control moisture, all right? This cord is to create gingival displacement. Remember, in peri, you've learned about the anatomy of the periodontal tissues. The fibers that you have on that area closer to the DJ, majority of the teeth, or that area, that you're gonna have let's say, the entrance of the biological with it is gingival elastic circular fibers, all right? Those are circular fibers. Those are elastic fibers, viscoelastic fibers. So you put the retraction cord also dry because it's easier to put the retraction cord dry. If you have a wet cord, it's just making a mess. So put a dry cord over there. Don't apply too much force. Sometimes I see bleeding, not because of the gingival tissue. Sometimes it's too much force. Be gentle with that. And then you put the cord around. Again, one cord, all right? Cut the cord with the correct size. I've seen people, I'm going to pack a small cord on the mesial, a small cord on the distal. No. Cut the cord with the size of the tooth. So if you think about there is a molar, the cord should have around 10 to 12 millimeters so that it can wrap around the entire cord. So it's basically you should have the mesial distal size of the tooth and then you cut as a cord. That's the normally the size that you need on the circumference of that cord. All right, now that you have everything dry, you're gonna start the impression. So you're gonna tell your assistant, hey, go ahead, get the Pentamix or the machine, that the dynamic mixing machine, and let's start it. Okay, so in that case, what you're gonna do is once you're about to start, you should wet the cord first. Pay attention, wet the cord first, and then you remove the cord, only the cord on top, the cord 0 or cord 1, and then you dry. why do I need to wet the cord if you just said that the wet cord is the worst thing? It's because if the cord is dry at that moment, what's gonna happen is that the retraction cord will attach to the gingiva. And when you remove the cord, simply it will start bleeding because it will peel the gingiva a little bit. So wet the cord just a little bit, air water spray, remove it, dry, and then you start with the light material. If you do that, you're gonna see that you're gonna even see the other cord underneath it. And then you're gonna make sure that you see all the prep. Light material, make sure to start on the occlusal area of the teeth adjacent to it or an area of no interest, and then you move your tip into it. We're gonna practice this in the lab, all right? And then you're gonna have the multiple mix technique happen, all right? So pay attention on this part of the lecture that is talking about the methods of gingival retraction, all right? So we avoid having to repeat that, okay? And just to continue here, let's go back to the sulfonate compounds here, all right? So water incompatibility, we are all good. So make sure that everything is dry. So now for sulfonate compounds, you have to pay attention that the retraction cord, if it's contaminated with hemodent or soaked in hemodent, besides not controlling the crevicular fluid, what happens is that astringent will inhibit the polymerization of the PVS, because the astringent is a sulfonate compound and then will kill the catalyst. So that's another problem of using too much hemodent during the impression. I'm not saying that you should never use it, but if you soak that and leave, like I sometimes dripping hemodent, that material that is into the soakers will not cure properly and will peel. That's related to the tear resistance of the material. If it doesn't peel sometimes, or I would say if it doesn't fracture, it will take longer to set. So the material will not have elastic recovery. So pay attention with this topic because it's important. Because I've seen that in the clinic happening so many times with me. We're gonna go ahead and do an impression. So sometimes the clinic is busy. Of course, you are all prepared. So you take a first impression and then you make the first impression. I take a look and say, that's not good. Let's take it again. And then you try to copy a margin. And then, of course, the second time they were doing it might be bleeding. So you put a lot of a hemodent. And then the second impression is worse than the first. So in this situation, when we discuss and you guys understand a little bit more that we should not soak completely in hemodent, you guys make a perfect impression. So pay attention with these tiny details because it's very frustrating to take like 3-4 impressions of the same patient. It's sometimes embarrassing because, you know, the patient start lose confidence on you. So you should put all the things together. So don't waste time. Get the confidence that we're looking for, right? I love when you folks go ahead in the first shot to take that beautiful impression. The patient is happy, I'm happy, everyone is happy. So pay attention to these tiny details. It's like 10 minutes of your life that you need to be focused and concentrated, and then you don't have to repeat the impression, all right? So pay attention with this. Very nice. So impression removal is the same principle as we said about, in this case, alginate, all right? So it needs to be in a quick shot. It's viscoelastic as well. Disinfection is very similar, all right? We use the same disinfectants, but there is a difference. PVS does not contain water in the composition, so you don't have to put the PVS inside a plastic bag. So this PVS material will not need to have this part, because if you see the composition, there is no water in it. And the other part is pouring. The very nice thing about PVS, and sometimes I tell you that in the clinic, and we do a lot of nice stuff, you have to do a custom, occlusal guard, a mouth guard, whatever that you need to do for your patient. And you notice that you are in the end of the appointment, you're not gonna be able to pour the cast right away, or something is happening. You can make an impression using PVS and pour later, all right? Because the beauty of the PVS, you can send the PVS impression to the lab. You don't need to pour the cast right away. That's what we do with final impressions. We send the impression to the lab. But there is one thing that you're gonna see in the books that might cause some confusion. So let me just explain this part for you regarding the pouring of PVS. There is one thing, one, I would say, property or chemical reaction that happens that is called hydrogen outgassing. What is that? So basically, whenever you see the PVS molecule, the structure of the PVS molecule on the siloxane monomer has this hydrogen over here. The issue is, whenever you have contamination with water during the process of setting the material, so let's say that contaminated with saliva, or let's say it had moisture on it, what happened is the water that is in the saliva, it will react with the hydrogen, and then it will remove this oxygen to the siloxane, and it will form a gas, a hydrogen gas, all right? So this hydrogen gas will stay entrapped into the PVS material. But the problem, it won't appear visually when you see. You're not going to see a void or a bubble into the stone, into the impression. But you're going to have to make an impression right away, correct? So the thing is, if you try to get that impression right away, what happened is the PVS is full of hydrogen gas, all right? This hydrogen gas is too light, so it will go through the pores of the material and will try to escape. So you have the tooth that you made the impression, you had water in the composite, in the contamination, and then the gas is forming to the material. If you put the stone and you wait the setting time of the stone, that is about 45 to 60 minutes, what happened is during this period, the gas will try to escape. So it will escape to the surface of the stone. And then whenever you remove the stone, what's going to happen is the stone will show a lot of small voids onto the surface. So that's what happens to the stone with hydrogen outgassing problems of the PVS. So what is the solution for it? So you have to wait 15 to 30 minutes for a majority of the PVSs before pouring, because in these 30 minutes, all the gases are released. You might have a small distortion, but it's like, because the mass of hydrogen is so small, it's minimum. And that way you don't have this thing. But nowadays you're gonna see that this is not happening anymore. Why? Because the manufacturers are adding what we a component to the composition of the PVS, that is the palladium. So what the palladium does is a heavy metal atom. So what does is, whenever the hydrogen outgassing is formed on a contamination situation, all right, guys, the palladium will hold the hydrogen outgassing into the material and not let it escape during the procedures. So the stone will be poured and the palladium will retain that. So in that case, there is no hydrogen outgassing with the materials containing palladium. So in the clinics, that's our case. So you can immediately pour the PVS, just avoid to having contamination with saliva. As I said, if you have a lot of water, then this can happen because it will form so much hydrogen that the palladium will not be sufficient. And again, you can pour the cast within 4 weeks, all right? Some manufacturers recommend less time, but that's the average of the material. So you can send that to the lab, you can do whatever you want. So PVS is a very interesting material for that standpoint. Now that we've gone through the PVS, let's talk about the polyether, right? The polyether is another type of addition silicon material. It's a very, very interesting material. It has very interesting properties, and the indications are the same as the ones for, as I said, for PVS. So study diagnostics and working casts. The composition is slightly different, although also has silica as the filler to control the viscosity. But you're gonna notice that the viscosity of the polyether tends to be a little bit more heavy because of the type of monomers that we have in the composition. So here, because the material, the monomers that I'm gonna show you, they are so heavy and big, the manufacturer needs to add two things to the composition to make sure that the material will not, let's say, be too hard. One is a solvent that is ethyl acetate. It's a solvent that it will dissolve the material, making it a little bit more fluid. The other one is the triglycerides. Those are plasticizers that are added to the composition to control the viscosity and also how the material will behave elastically whenever is set. And the monomer that is driving is the polyether copolymer, all right? The monomer that is gonna be doing. It's a resident type of ring, and then you're gonna see the reaction in a few times. in a few minutes. And the catalyst of polyether is actually dichlorobenzene sulfonate. So this one is a sulfonate compound that, if you think about, you cannot use PVS and polyether together because the catalyst will react with that. But here's the reaction. So as I said, it's a ring opening type of reaction, okay? It's a cationic reaction that is also considered an addition polymerization reaction. So the catalyst, the sulfonate compound, will go to the polyether and will open those rings, the arisidin rings, and then these rings will connect to the next one, and then you're gonna form a polymer of the monomer polyether, okay? So in this case, you have polyether. Very nice. There's no putty of this material, okay? The putties are not stable enough. So we have the hand cartridges and the bowl cartridges, and the consistency that you're gonna see in the market are light, medium, basically, all right? Sometimes you have extra light, but you're not gonna see a heavy consistency for polyether. It's too heavy already. So in this case, we're gonna go for the same rules here that we're discussing. We have proportionally mixing, is exactly like the ones for PVS. It's exactly the same cartridge, the same dispenser. The only difference is the mixing tips. So you're gonna notice on the lab sessions that the mixing tips are slightly different in color and in size. The impression technique. So for the impression technique, there is a difference on the tray adhesive. So the tray adhesive now is a polyether tray adhesive. It's not a PVS tray adhesive. And you can use basically the same techniques that I discussed. Putty wash, multiple mix, and monophase. Putty wash, it's very, very rare to be used with polyether. It doesn't work well, so forget it. The ones that are more commonly used are multiple mix and monophase, okay? Multiple mix are the ones that you're gonna use for impressions of crowns, bridges, pickup, impressions of implants. Those are very nice materials. And monophase is actually my favorite type of material to use for complete dentures. So you can use PVS, of course, but you're gonna understand why polyether is interesting. Polyether is kind of a hydrophilic material, so you don't have to worry about too much of drying the palate or dealing with moisture on the dentulous ridge. So that's a very, very interesting material. Now, there are two things here that will change on polyether. First of all, water compatibility. There's no issue with water. I'm not saying that you can do what I call submarine dentistry, but there is a material that is more tolerable to moisture. So it's interesting in cases where you have a dentulous ridge where you cannot completely dry. In a case there, you have a subgingival prep that you cannot control the moisture pretty well and you need to make the impression. And the second part is related to sulfonate compounds that I will explain in a bit. So since the material is hydrophilic, it will go with water pretty well. Just for you to have an understanding, these are two coins submerged in water, one being we're making impression with PVS and the other one with the polyether. So after the impression, if you remove the coins and take a look, PVS does a terrible job while polyether submerged in water does a pretty decent job. So you might see some voids over there, but it's a material that is hydrophilic. Now, you must try the area where you're making the impression. Polyether, although can tolerate water better, doesn't mean that you can simply completely full in water. You need to have a dry area so it will perform the best. And the second part is sulfonate compounds. There is no issue with polyether and astringent. So if you are in a situation where you need to apply the astringent, a lot of hemodent or viscostat, whatever, because it's the situation that you have, you may have to do a gingivectomy and make an impression for, I don't know, something forward, the best option will be polyether, right? Because there is no problem. Actually, the catalyst is a sulfonate compound. Of course, if you have too much of sulfonate compound, it can set a little bit faster, but it's not a big deal. Again, ideally, you should follow the same principles that I just explained for PVS. Then your life is gonna be way easier. And do not use PVS and polyether together. Some people might be thinking, oh, so can I combine? I use the tray, the PVS and the light of polyether. Don't attempt that. It's not gonna do. One is gonna not allow the polymerization of the other, and that's the situation. And to clean that in the patient's mouth, it's terrible, right? So pay attention with this. And there's a third property here that I want to talk about. It's pseudoplastic behavior. So the polyether is a material that can assume different pseudoplastic behavior. What is that, Dr. Rocha? So now it's time for you to learn a little bit more on the basics of material, okay? So whenever you have a liquid or a fluid, they can assume different behavior. Depending on the pressure, the material can increase viscosity, maintain viscosity, or reduce viscosity. So for example, a plastic material is a material that will need some pressure to move or to flow. So for example, ketchup. If you try to get ketchup and leave it, it will have what we call thixotropic behavior, and the material will stay in that position. Once you shake the bottle or press and put pressure, the material will flow. So that's the secret that the bottles of ketchup they have. They have some sort of a mechanism to increase the pressure into the dispensing area to make the material flow. So there is a requires a small pressure to the material to flow. The dilatant fluid are the ones that once you press, the material becomes harder or more viscous. So a good example of a dilatant type of fluid is if you mix water with cornstarch. So if you get that, you're gonna, if you go very slowly, you're gonna be able to move through the material. But if you try to tap, the material is pretty hard like a rock. Newtonian fluid is water, right? This is constant. But there is this one called pseudoplastic behavior, which is very interesting for impression materials. It's a material that if you increase the pressure, the shear stress of the material will reduce viscosity. So for example, if I pass that material from, let's say a solid material through a syringe, a very small needle, the material will reduce the viscosity. Why is this so interesting? Because with one viscosity, you can have two viscosities of material for the impression. So for example, here is a situation. Just for you to know, this is because of the triglycerides plasticizer. How did they work? Let's say that you want to get polyether, you just mix that and put on the syringe or use on the syringe straight away. So whenever you put on a syringe and then you have the all the chains of plasticizers and polyether copolymers inside, completely randomly, in a randomly allocation, not aligned, once you try to press that material and pass that through a small part, what happens is the material will align those triglycerides, and then the material will start to reduce the viscosity. So a medium viscosity polyether, when passes through a syringe, becomes almost a low viscosity polyether. So that's interesting, for example, for monophase techniques. If you're doing impression using complete dentures, for example, you can have right away when it comes out of the tray, the material in a low viscosity, and then it will attach to the tray, and then it will be way easier. But polyether is excellent, and it's a very nice material, but you're gonna see that we don't use that often because there are some drawbacks of using polyether, all right? You're gonna see that 90% of the clinical cases you're gonna solve with PVS, but you might have some situations here and there that you might need to use polyether. So polyether are the ones that can have some issues, especially with teeth periodontally compromised, because the material is a little bit harder, and then you're gonna see whenever you try to remove the impression. So if you have any undercuts, the material will be harder to remove. The second one is allergic reaction. If the patient has allergy to latex, very likely the patient will have allergy to polyether. So here is just for teeth periodontally compromised. If you have a situation like that where you have an undercut and you make an impression with polyether, that's a pretty big problem, all right? And then here you can see that the impression was pretty good. You can even see the retraction cord, but that's an issue that can happen. And again, polyether can cause allergic reactions. So this clinical case here, what happened is the patient started to have these white lesions, leukoplakia type of lesions. And then these will affect within 48 hours of making the impression. And what we should do is after a week, it should be gone. And in this case, it's not a big deal if it can be revert. But again, this is a situation where the patient will be sore and all that. You should not induce an allergic reaction, because you can have a allergic reaction response that might be causing some anaphylaxis reaction as well, okay? Now, polyether is very interesting, but again, as I said, there are a couple of drawbacks on it. And there are a couple of things related to the gloves. So there is no problem with the gloves. You can use latex glove, but the sign that the patient will not be using polyether is I have allergy to latex or any type of sulfonate compounds. All right, impression removal, you already know. It's the same for all materials, viscoelastic materials. Now, you're gonna go for the disinfection. It's the same principle as the PVS. The material has basically no problems with stability. And pouring, the pouring of the polyether is slightly different than PVS. So although polyether, you can, according to the manufacturer, pour within 7 days and it's stable, pretty stable. Ideally, you should pour within 24 hours, okay? Because the solvents, they can evaporate. Of course, you could, if you keep on a refrigerated ambient and things like that, it's not a big problem. But sometimes you want to send a cast to the lab, and you know we are in Florida, it's a very hot and humid heat, and then during transportation, your cast might be above, let's say, 23 degrees Celsius. That will be something that will evaporate the solvent. So it's not recommended to send the polyether all the time for the lab. Although majority of the cases, you're gonna be in a good situation. It's because of the solvent that can evaporate, okay? And as the reaction continues as well, the material will start to shrink a little bit more. Now, that we discussed about the impression materials, we're gonna move to the dental stones, okay? The dental stones are very important because those are the final products for the modem, all right? And the ones that we're talking about here today is the gypsum products, okay? In this case, you might be wondering, how can I make a rock like this one made of gypsita be transformed into a model? How can I make this a powder? It's not just grinding that powder and using. There's a process to get to this point. So the stones are made with two different products. You have the powder here that is basically stone powder, and then you have the water. In this case, the water doesn't matter much if the water is distilled or not. Actually, the water is with contamination. I'm not saying dirty water, okay? But they can end up serving to areas for the material to start crystallizing. So first of all, how this is formed? So these rocks here, they are calcinated, and then they are in the nature as calcium sulfate dehydrate. And once you heat up that, you form what we call calcium sulfate hemihydrate, all right? This is the powder that you're gonna receive to make your dental stones. Depending on how these powders are obtained, these form different types of crystals within that powder. If you have what we call open kettle in a temperature around 110 to 120 degrees Celsius, you're gonna form one type of powder. If you put that powder in a high pressure steam, a little bit higher temperature, you're gonna have that powder with a different configuration. And if you put that in a boiling solution with calcium chloride, you're gonna have even a different configuration. And this is important because each powder is gonna determine what is the type of stone that you have. So the first powder here is the one that you do in an open kettle. So this one in an open kettle is forming what we call beta hemihydrate. It's a type of powder or crystal that is spongy, irregular in shape, which means that you're gonna need more water, and is a material that will have more expansion, more distortion, and also less resistance. If you have this on a steam kind of obtention, powder obtention, you're gonna have what we call alpha hemihydrate. These now are more prismatic, they sort of a mixed shape, and this kind of powder will require less water. This way, it will be a little bit higher in resistance and also have less expansion. And the third one is the one in the calcium chloride boiling solution, where you're gonna have a modified alpha hemihydrate. those are cubic shape, regular shape. So those are all in the same orientation. In this case, you're gonna request, you're gonna need less water, even less water and more resistance. So based on that type of powders, you can classify the different type of stones, okay? For beta hemihydrate, you're gonna classify not as a stone, but as a plaster, okay? So you have type 1 and type 2 plaster. The type 1 plaster is the one that we discussed as impression plaster, is extinguished. You're not gonna see that anymore. Type 2 model plaster, you might see that around, even those are the ones that are using construction. But in dentistry, we use sometimes to mount different types of articulators and things like that. Although nowadays people are using more the type 3 mounting stone. Now, for alpha hemihydrate, we're gonna have the dental stone, okay? That starts the dental stone type 3. These are, for example, dental stones that you use for making diagnostic models, sometimes working cash for a custom trade. These are ones that are gonna have some sort of good, let's say, accuracy, but can expand a little bit more. They're not abrasive resistant, so it's more for this type of work. Type 4 are the dental stones high strength. So type 4 is the most commonly used ones, and also the type 4 is the one they're gonna use for any type of working cast. Type 5 is rarely used in dentistry, I would say, by the clinician. It's more towards the lab. So the dental stone type 5 is a high strength, high expansion. So for example, if you're making a RPD and you have to create the cast so you can wax up the RPD in the right size, so whenever it shrinks to the right dimension, use a type 5 stone that will expand, and whenever the alloy shrinks, it will get to the right size. Again, type 1 is not used, type 5 you're not gonna see anymore. Type 1 you're not gonna see anymore, and type 5 is rarely used. Type 3 you might use as a mounting stone as well, okay? Now, gypsum. It's pretty easy as well to understand how to use those materials. Proportioning, mixing, pouring, disinfection. Here, disinfection is more towards if you don't make a disinfection on the impression, which should be ideal. And also sometimes if you have some situations like we had during COVID, you have to disinfect that model with a specific type of solution. And trimming. Now, you can have pre-weighted bags and bulk bags. The ones that I recommend for stone is pre-weighted bags, okay? It's the cost efficient is pretty similar to the bulk bags. And this way you don't have to have a scale to weight the powder and all of that. Although it's not a complicated. Even if you buy the bulk bags, what I recommend you to do is to pre-weight everything bags, ask your assistant to do that, and that makes your life way easier. Now, depending on the type of stone that you have, you're gonna have different regulations or different, let's say, water powder ratio. As lower is the type of the stone, so if it's alpha hemihydrate in this case, you need more water, as I said. As the type of the stone increases, you need less water, okay? This amount of water, it's important because as less water as you have, you're gonna have less expansion. Of course, type 5 is slightly different. There is a different type of composition on it. I'm not gonna go deep into that. But you're gonna have less expansion and more resistance of the stone. But read the manufacturing instructions. Every stone bag come in the back with the instructions regarding water powder ratio, okay? And also working time and setting time. These are slightly different. You can adjust the working time of the stone. Don't think that you can do that with the temperature of water. It doesn't work. If you put hot water and cold water, actually you are retarding sometimes the reaction, okay? Because the type of reaction is not a polymerization. It's what we call dissolution and precipitation. So in this case, if you wanna accelerate the setting reaction of the dental stone, what you need to put inside the dental stone is table salt. So you put a pinch of table salt, and then it will do. It's sodium chloride, that's the one. Or you can use the water that comes from the trimming. Or you can just make get a little bit of the powder, put in water and make a slurry water. Because how the reaction of the stone works, and I'll show you in a minute, but basically is the crystals, they precipitate and they are formed, and then they can go ahead and form the crystals and create the stone. Here are basically the most common water powder ratios, all right? So you can see here that the dental stone they're gonna be using here are gonna be around 0.22 to 0.24 per 100 gram, if I'm not wrong, okay? And the setting time is around 12 minutes. Those are just properties that these ones have to have according to the ADA specification. Here's just one that is very common to be used, is a yellow iso type 4 stone, okay, low expansion dye stone, where you're gonna have 100 grams of powder to 23 milliliters of water. The pink stone that you're gonna be, I'm sorry, the snap stone that you're gonna be using, it's gonna be slightly different. It's gonna be a stone that you're gonna require 33 milliliters of water. That's the one on the lab exercise. You're gonna see that in the back. This is a type 4 as well. Mixing. So mixing the stone is pretty straightforward. First, you put the water. Again, the water is always first because you don't wanna have the powders on the walls of the bowl, because this way you're not gonna wet completely the powder and then you're gonna take longer to mix. It's not gonna cause problems, but you wanna mix faster. And then you put the powder, the pre-weighted powder, and then you start the mixture. So the mixture here is different from the alginate. You don't need to spatulate and compress the powder. You just need to make sure that all these little, let's say, pigments that you have are completely mixed, all right? And you use a metal spatula. The plastic spatula is not good for it because the powder of a stone is very coarse, so you'll start to scratch the spatula and release plastics into it. So use a metal spatula, basically a spatula for stone, not for, don't use the alginate spatula because then you're contaminating the alginate. Mix well, and then you should see these shiny surface, and the material will have what we call thixotropic behavior, which means that if you put on the vibrator, the material will flow. So that's an important thing also when you're pouring. You're gonna notice that you're gonna use a stone vibrator to make that material flowing. But if you take too long, the material will start to have some issues and will show some, it will be too hard to be used. One important thing here, and I want you to pay attention to this slide, is the setting reaction, okay? In a normal setting reaction, basically, I will show you a video in a few seconds, the calcium hemihydrate will get the water from the solution, and then will start to precipitate. And this precipitation will form crystals, and those sites of crystallization will start to grow. And as it grows, it will interlock, and that way the material will start to harden and set. Now come problems that you can have with the stone, and you might be asking, why my crown is not sitting well and all of that. I passed the QA, but when you receive, all of that is a problem that can happen in a very small situation, but it only gonna be shown whenever you deliver the work. One is, if you put too much water, instead of having a normal setting condition, you're gonna have what we call hygroscopic expansion. So we have a normal expansion of the stone, which is fine and should happen, but we have hygroscopic expansion of the stone. This is when you have so much water that the crystals are so far apart that the crystals, they start to form far away. First of all, the material will lose resistance, but also they will expand because they will conform to the all solution that you create. So make sure that you respect the powder. The second one is over spatulation. People sometimes spatulate the stone forever. Once mix is mixed, because what happens? Every time a crystal is formed and start to precipitate, if you go ahead and break the crystal, you form a new nuclei, and that new nuclei will start a reaction again, and then will start to grow the crystals. So if you have two crystals growing, they will grow and will have a certain, let's say, force to grow or amount of dimension that it can grow. Now, if you have 4 to 6 crystals trying to grow to the same size, you have them pushing to each other and the material starts to expand. So over-spatulation can also cause expansion of the stone. So this is how it works. This is an image of a crystal growing. So as you can see here, you have the water that starts to hydrate the crystals and start to form those crystals. So you see when the crystals start to get to each other, they push each other and they start to interlock. So whenever those forces, they are, imagine those are chemical forces, they are pushing the stone outwards. So make sure that you respect the time of mixing. So don't pass the mixing time. Don't over-spatulate. You need to spatulate fast, but don't over-spatulate. And respect the water-powder ratio. Again, if you change that, you make what I call panera bread type of dentist. That either you make a bread or you make a soup, okay? It's too much powder here, too much water here. And those who are causing problems. Both of them, first of all, in a bread situation, you're not going to be able to pour. You're not going to copy the details. And if you put more water thinking that you're going to have nice details, well, you might capture those details, but once the material sets, they will deform. So they will look the details completely deformed. So in the exercises, for example, if you try to seat the bridge, it's not going to seat. So pay attention. This is the machine that you're going to be using for the stones. For the lab exercise, you're going to do hand spatulation. But if you're using a regular stone like a silky rock, you're going to use this type of vacuum mixing. So the vacuum mixing is excellent, the mechanical spatulation, because with that type of mixture, you can remove all the air entrapped into that mixture. That way, the material will spatulate pretty well and fast, okay? So the way that it works, let me show the video here again. First, you have to mix a little bit the material inside that cup, the whip mix cup. Don't just put both together and put it in. It will not work, so you have to mix just a little bit. And then you can put the vacuum first, and then you attach the machine. And then there is a little trigger that whenever you press, the machine will start. And then you mix for the mixing time according to the manufacturer. All right, so now comes the pouring. So make sure to respect the time of pouring. If you pass too much the initial setting time, it will be hard. You're not going to be able to do it. Now for pouring, you have to start with a small spatula on an area far away, I would say, of the area of interest. You turn on your stone vibrator. The stone vibrator, it's covered with plastic. And then use a small spatula and that let the material flow into those spaces, okay? So once you see the material flow in those spaces, you make sure you're gonna see that some bubbles will start to come out of the material. You don't need to keep the material into the vibrator for the entire period. What I mean is, once you cover completely the teeth area and also the ridges here, you can remove that from the stone vibrator. Because if you continue vibrating, and if you try to create the base for that material, what's gonna happen? The material continue flowing and then you're not gonna be able to do it. So just make sure to use the stone vibrator only to make this first part of the areas of interest, which will be teeth, edentulous ridge, vestibule, things in that direction. Now, here are the steps. So just the same thing. And now that you have the base, what you can do is you can get the material and form a base. There are a couple ways to do the base. You can just leave the material in the same position and make the base with your spatula. You can put that on a glass plate and then or a tile and then you make the plate, make the base again. You can use the base former. You folks receive the base former, so you can put the material inside the stone inside the base former and flip over. There are many ways. The only recommendation that I give is don't put on paper. I see many of you just getting the butcher paper over there and then putting the stone into that. What happened is the paper will get the water from the stone, okay? The water is still present over there and it's needed for the impression, for the material to set. So if you put it on paper, it will absorb that. So put on a tile, put on a glass plate, put on a former, a base former, all right? and wait the waiting time, the setting time of the stone, okay? The stone during setting, it will get warmer and then will cool down. And after the cooling, it's basically on the final setting time. What is important to pay attention is, in some materials such as alginate, if you leave too long, you're gonna have problems because the stone interacts with the alginate, and then even after the reaction of the stone is set, the alginate will start to cause some problems on the surface. That's basically the calcium sulfate acting on the surface of the stone and continuing the reaction, forming alginic acid. And the alginic acid ends up corroding the surface of the stone. So those are important things. So here it is, common mistakes, getting a huge spatula and try to pour everything at the same time. You're gonna have a lot of voids inside. You see, when you cut a lot of voids inside of it, so it's because you're not pouring using the vibrator and using a small spatula. And this is the reaction that I was talking about. You see the porous surface? This is the reaction between calcium sulfate, alginate, and the stone, and that will form alginic acid. And this surface is basically, it's a sandcastle. And then if you touch, it starts to flick it off, and that doesn't work. If you try to make a wax up, it will deattach. Anything works, and it's very, it fractures with nothing. So pay attention, don't leave your alginate for too long. So after the stone is poured, try to remove within 1-2 hours, okay? More than 24 hours, it's a problem for the stone. Pouring, it's the, we just talked about it. So now the solubility. It's important for you, whenever you're deciding to trim, that the material can become soluble again, all right? So ideally, you should wait the material to completely set, and the stone, it has the setting part where we're gonna have the material with the wet strength, which means there's still water in the material, and the dry strength. So we need to wait the material to completely be on a dry strand. That's about 2-3 hours, okay? After the initial setting time for majority of the stones. After that, the material can start to become soluble, okay? So whenever you're going to cut the stone, what you need to do is you need to get a slurry water that is basically water with a little bit of stone inside. It even can be the water that comes from the trimmer, okay? So that one, you can go ahead and use that water to get the stone that is dry and put inside. That will reduce the solubility of the stone, and then you can start trimming. Whenever you're doing the trimming right away, you just finish the setting, what can happen is the material is not completely set, and when you're trying to make the trimming, it will form a gooey type of paste that can attach back to the gypsum, and then you're going to see that you're going to have little pellets on areas that should not have. So pay attention with that. And here on the disinfection, I will talk about more on the solubility and trimming, but the disinfection is related to if you need to clean the model, you can use a sodium ammonium chloride type of cavi wipe. But again, pass that on the slurry water first, and then you pass the cavi wipe, and then the opticide or cavicide, and then you weigh the time for acting is the same as the one from alginate. It's 5 minutes. Then you pass in slurry water again. Never try to wash the stone with pure water because you're gonna dissolve the stone. So use slurry water, okay? A water contaminated with stone. And trimming, that's the part that I said. You see slurry water over there to wet the stone? You start on the base. You're gonna make sure that you understand what are the landmarks. So make the occlusal plane parallel to it, and then you cut the base first. And then from that, you can cut the area on the posterior, and then you can make the cuttings on the other areas. Pay attention with your finger on that. You have that platform to help you. And here you have the areas that related to the dimensions. So ideally you should have at least 1/3 of the model with base, okay? So that way, that's the ideal landmarks for it. But of course, there are some variations that you might want to have. Very nice. Now that we've talked about all these materials and the dental stone, I'll just pass real quick on new materials and technologies because these are going to be very important for you going forward. Alginate substitute. You might see around the clinics or somewhere that you go, alginate substitute. You might be thinking, oh, that's an alginate. No, it's not, okay? So alginate substitute is basically a PVS with the indications of alginate. Basically, it's a bad PVS. Is it interesting to have those? Yes, because as alginate, you have to pour the impression right away. With the alginate substitute, you can make the impression and send the impression to the lab, which is great for occlusal guards, for mouth guards, for orthodontic appliances, with Invisalign if you're not making any type of scanning. So these are great. Now, what are the differences? First of all is the cost, okay? For a full arch impression, alginate, it will cost you around $4.50. Alginate substitute, depending on the brand, it's $11 to $20, okay? So pay attention. Sometimes it compensates because you're not gonna have a cost of having stone, time of your system, pouring the stone, and things in that direction. The other technology that you're gonna see around and people trying to claim, there are a couple of companies that said, we came with the most modern material. It's called VPES. What is VPES? They realized that they wanna combine the properties of PVS with the properties of polyether. All right, and they came with this monomer VPES. But I'll tell you that it doesn't work that way. Why? If you read the patent of that material, you're gonna see that indeed has PVS and polyether. But since these are incompatible, how come you can mix these together and make a product? So the if you go to the patent of these materials, you're gonna see that what the chemists they did, they got the monomer V, they split it apart, making a space in the middle. They got the monomer polyether, and then they cut a section in the middle, and then they got this section in the middle, and they put in the middle of the monomer V, creating the monomer VPE, vinyl polyether, all right? So now they got this monomer vinyl polyether, and they mix that with a platinum salt and a monomer S, the siloxane, creating a monomer, a polymer of the monomers VP and S. So then you have VPES. But if you think about is an addition polymerization reaction, use a catalyst as a platinum salt, and then it reacts exactly like a PVS. If you take a look on the properties, it's no more hydrophilic. It's a little bit, I would say it's a little bit more hydrophilic than, I would say less hydrophobic than PVS, but it still is not sufficient for comparing to the polyether in the conditions, okay? This is because the VPES is 90% PVS and 10% polyether. So that amount of polyether doesn't make a difference. So the material is more expensive and actually is a PVS. So if you wanna use it, use like a PVS, all right? Don't think that you're using a material that is better than PVS. It's just the same thing as PVS. They're great, but they're just PVS. And here I'm talking about a lot in analog dentistry, which means that you have the real impression materials, you have the real casts. But it doesn't mean that those information cannot be transferred to a digital workflow, all right? If you see me in the clinics, you're gonna see that I'm gonna push you towards doing a lot of things in the digital dentistry. So I'm gonna tell you to scan your casts, your impressions, everything, because it can make your life way easier. Because of course you will learn how to do the analog way, and I'm gonna teach you both ways, the analog and the digital way. And when you make a digital model, there are a lot of benefits of it. First of all, physical space. You can do digital designs where you can tweak that in a very convenient way, so you can have your laptop and then work with that in different environments. There are many things that you can be doing with it. And this world of digital dentistry, I highly recommend you to engage to it, all right? The only way to learn is to use, is to execute. If you ask me, when I learned dentistry, we didn't have scanners that were sufficient. I started, my first type of scanner was the blue can. And the blue can was the one that we had to powder. It was a nightmare. When I came here to UF, we had a very nice program already with the Plumeca systems. And I learned so much Plumeca. And these made my life so much easier. Delivering crown the same day, having digital walk-ups using the ExoCAD, everything's so great. And we're here to teach you, folks. So engage to that. We have digital dentistry elective courses. We have a new digital hub also that you have scanners, you have printers. It's marvelous, okay? But the thing is, don't think that if you start with analog, you have to end up with analog, okay? You can move your models to digital. So in this case, for example, you have desktop scanners that you can scan either the model or impression and transform that to a digital model. Also, you can get in every clinic, we have a Emerald system over there that you can scan the impression. So use that, okay? Digitize your models. Show to your faculty on the senior case presentations, the digital files. Come and print that, okay? And then with that, you can see, for example, this is a scanner from Serec, where basically you put the cast over there and the laser will digitize that model. We have the ones from Trios here in the school. Or you can do intraoral scan, okay? Most of the cases where you have supergingival margins, you can do an intraoral scan. So if you finish a COE earlier and then you have the opportunity, besides the alginate impression in the model, make an intraoral impression with the intraoral scanner, because the impression with the intraoral scanner will be better than the alginate impression with the stone. It's more precise, okay? Because the impression with the stone, the accuracy is 75 microns if it's done perfectly, while the precision of scanners are down to 20 microns, all right? So don't lose your time in the clinics. Make impressions with digital scanners as well, okay? Both of them. So here are the intraoral scanners. We have different scanners available for you, so just get familiar with this. There is no other way to learn besides using it, okay? As more as you use, more you're gonna get proficient. It doesn't mean that you need to do for a crown, do for any type of impression. Again, if you don't know how to make an impression on analog, don't also try to move straight to the digital, okay? The thing is, the same principles of impression on analog way needs to be on the digital. So retraction, let's say that you decide to make a crown and make the impression with an intraoral scanner. If you don't respect the same principles that I said about retraction cord, then you're gonna have a problem, all right? The difference here is, for example, the hemodent might not be a big issue, but you have saliva coming, and if you have water on the surface doing scanning, you're gonna notice that it's reflective, and that reflection does not allow to capture. So again, even on the digital, you need to have a dry prep, clear margins, everything seen. If you cannot see with your eyes, the scanner cannot see it. And whenever you are going back, and sometimes you need to make a model back, so you can 3D print those. So these 3D printers, they use a type of vat that is a resin tank filled with resin, and a laser light or a LED light goes onto those layer by layer, constructing the model in a 3D in a resin base. Those are way better than stones, because the thing is, first of all, the wear resistance is way better. The precision tends to be I would say stones can, depending on the resolution of your printer, stones can be better, okay? But for majority of the clinical cases, you're gonna print with a precision of 25 microns, which is enough. And those are way more resistant. How many times you were doing a walk-up or doing something and then you scrape on a stone and then it's done? So if you have a resin material, that it's way easier. And not only that, you can make the digital walk-up and then you print already the final, and then you make your putty from the 3D file, all right? So everything with this is available for you. So be on top of it, all right? We have the PlanCAD Premium, we have many things. Anyway, and this is the digital design, all right? The digital design, you can do whatever you want and then create custom trays, create whatever you want. And a nice thing as well that you're going to be exploring CAD/CAM clinic is that you can send straight away to milling machines and mill the crown. Whenever you're making onlays and inlays, you're going to see that provisional of those are terrible. It's very hard to make. They don't stay. It's terrible. So the best thing to do is whenever you're doing inlays and onlays, make same day dentistry. I would say the same for crowns. Whenever you are in the scene lab, whenever you are in the clinics, ask your faculty that are doing a lot of those. So Dr. Oliveira, Dr. Ray, so these folks, Dr. Delgado, these folks are doing so many of those in the faculty practice. Ask them how efficient they became whenever they got the CAD/CAM system working smoothly. They can deliver a crown the same day. And I want you folks to do the same, all right? So let's work on this together, okay? And again, if you cannot sing a good song on a vinyl record, the song is not gonna look good on a Spotify, iTunes, YouTube, on a digital world. So good prep, good impression, good technique, everything will only work if you are good on analog way. So practice the analog way before you do digital for a couple of cases. So for example, make alternate impressions of, let's say, your first 2-3 COEs. And then after that, if you have time, go ahead and do a scan, all right? If you're doing cases for crowns, check with your faculty if you already got the requirements to start doing some scanning. And it doesn't mean that you're gonna deliver the case with a digital, but at least you're practicing. By the time that you wanna deliver a case with digital, impression with digital, you're gonna be good with that. And again, you never get a second chance to make a good first impression, but again, you always have a chance to make a good dental impression. Thank you so much. I'll see you around. And if you have any questions, just send me an email. Thank you. Bye.